Hi everyone. So welcome to another video on theories of business cycle. So this video we will be solving previous year questions from this particular topic, theories of business cycle. So the first question, which was asked in 2012 December paper 3. So the question goes like this: there are four phases of a business cycle. Identify the correct sequence of occurrence of three phases. So the introductory lecture we have seen that there are mainly four phases to a business cycle. So it starts with the recovery phase, then expansion phase, then recession phase, and depression phase. So after depression phase, again there will be a recovery phase, there will be an expansion phase, then after that there will be again recession phase, and finally depression phase. So this just goes like a cycle, a business cycle. So it starts with recovery, then comes expansion, then comes recession, depression, again recovery, expansion, recession, depression, again recovery, and just goes on like that. So four options are given here. The first option say recovery, recession, expansion, depression. So after recovery they have given recession instead of expansion. So option A is not correct. Let's go to option B. Started with recovery, expansion, depression, and recession. The problem with option B is that they started with recovery, which is fine, then expansion, which is correct order, then after expansion, instead of recession they have given depression. So after expansion it should be recession, and after recession it should be depression. So option B is also not correct. So coming to option C, depression, expansion, recession, recovery. It started with depression, which can be true if it is followed by recovery phase. So it started with depression, which is absolutely fine, there is no issue. But after depression, instead of recovery, they have given expansion. So it should be recovery after depression. So since they have given expansion instead of recovery in option C, the option is wrong. So coming to option D, recovery, expansion, recession, and depression, which is the correct order. So they started with the recovery, then expansion, then recession, then depression, which is the correct order. See, what really matters here is the sequential order. Depression is given first in the option, that is absolutely fine. If that depression is followed by recovery, then again then expansion, then recession, and depression. So that sequential order is what matters in the case of phases of business cycle, that a depression should be followed by a recovery should be followed by expansion should be followed by recession, and recession should be followed by depression, and again that depression should be followed by recovery. So the sequential order is what really matters in the case of phases of business cycle. So in this option, option D is the correct answer, with recovery, expansion, recession, and depression. So the same question was again repeated in 2013 December paper 3. So the same question, the same question was asked in the exact same way without even changing the options. So here also the correct answer is option D, which is recovery, expansion, recession, and depression. So what really matters here is the sequential order. Even if depression is given first in the option instead of recovery, that may be correct if it is followed by correct sequential order. For example, depression followed by recovery followed by expansion followed by recession followed by depression, again depression followed by recovery, and so on. So what really matters here is the sequential order of phases of business cycle. We'll move on to so the answer is option D. So we'll move on to another question. This was asked in 2012 December paper 3. So the question is, which of the following models of business cycle generate constraint cycles? So we have to look at the model which creates constrained business cycle. So four options are given: Samuelson's model, Hicks model, Caldor's model, all of the above. So we have to see each option separately, or we have to see each model separately to arrive at the answer. So we'll start with Samuelson's model. So Samuelson's model, actually Samuelson's model and Hicks model are kind of similar. Samuelson's model and Hicks model talks about multiplier accelerator interaction in order to generate business cycle in the economy. So both Samuelson and Hicks says that it is because of accelerator multiplier interaction that business cycle happens in an economy. So the difference between Samuelson's model and Hicks model is that In the case of Hicks model, there is an upper ceiling and a bottom limit. So that is the main difference between Hicks model and Samuelson's model. Both these models are kind of similar, because both the models, Samuelson's model and Hicks model, says that the business cycles happens in an economy because of the interaction between multiplier and accelerator. And the difference between Samuelson's model and Hicks model is that in the case of Hicks model, there is an upper ceiling and a bottom limit. So the business cycle or the fluctuation which is happening in the economy has to happen within that certain limit. That is, there is an upper ceiling, and there is a bottom limit. So whatever cyclical fluctuation is happening in the economy according to Hicks model should take place within that particular limit. In Samuelson's model also, he says that there is an upper limit for upswing and a lower limit for downswing. And there is also a difference between Samuelson's model and Hicks model. Even though Samuelson also says about an upper limit, it is quite different from what Hicks has said. The difference is that in Samuelson's model, that particular limit is at the at the full potential, at the full potential employment level, or whenever resources are fully employed, that is the upper limit for Samuelson's model. So whenever there is no resources available in the economy, whenever there is full employment, whenever all the resources are utilized in the economy, then that is the upper limit for Samuelson's model. But in the case of Hicks model, that upper ceiling can happen even before full employment level. So Hicks basically says that the ceiling can be at the full employment level, just like Samuelson's model, but it can also happen at a lower level. Even before reaching that particular full employment level, a kind of a ceiling can be there and a downswing can take place. So the major difference between Samuelson's model and Hicks model is that in Hicks model, he says that there is an upper limit, there is an upper ceiling and a bottom limit, and this upper limit can take place even before the economy reaches full employment level. So and Hicks further says that whatever fluctuation happened in the economy, or whatever fluctuation can be witnessed in the economy, or the business cycle happens only within these limits, that is upper ceiling and bottom limit. And he also says that, which is very important for this question, that the business cycle will be like the movement of a pendulum. So there will be cyclical oscillation or a systematic movement of business cycle, just like a pendulum swings as it is systematic. The same kind of a pattern can also be seen in the case of Hicks model of business cycle, because of the upper limit, the upper ceiling and lower limit. So Hicks business cycle always happens within that upper limit and lower limit, and it always follows a pattern of a pendulum clock, or the movement of a pendulum, that whatever business cycle is happening, whatever business cycle is witnessed in the economy, that will be confined or constrained or restricted within that particular limit. So Hicks model, in other words, can we say that Hicks business cycle is confined or restricted within the upper ceiling and bottom limit. So and the third option is Kaldor's model. In Kaldor's model, he mainly focus on technological shocks. Kaldor's model says that it is technological shocks which leads to technological shocks or capital stock which leads to generation of business cycle in the economy. So we cannot consider Kaldor's model for this option, because Kaldor's model does not generate a constrained cycles. So out of these three options, it is Hicks model where business cycle is confined to a certain limit or within a box. It is similar to business cycle within a box or within a limit. So the answer to this question is option B, Hicks model. We say Hicks model because of upper ceiling and bottom limit, and whatever happens in the economy, or the fluctuations happen in the economy, that happens within this upper limit and upper limit and lower limit, and that upper limit can be at a point even before the point of full employment, which is totally different from Samuelson's model. So Samuelson's model and Hicks model are quite similar, but in the case of Hicks model, there is an upper ceiling, and that upper ceiling can take place even before reaching full employment level. So since because of that upper ceiling and lower limit, we say that Hicks model is confined or restricted within that particular limit, and it always follows a pattern of a pendulum movement, that a cyclical oscillation or a systematic oscillation can be seen in the case of Hicks model. And because of Hicks cycle, Bissner cycle is restricted within those limits, we can say that Hicks model is constrained or restricted or confined. So the Bissner cycle in terms of Hicks model is constrained cycles or restricted cycles or confined cycles. So the answer to this question is option B, Hicks model. So we'll move on to next question. So this question was asked in 2013 June NET exam in paper 2. So the question is this: whose model of the following economist make use of the stock adjustment principle to explain business cycles? We have four options: Nicholas Calder, J.R. Hicks, Paul Samuelson, and J.M. Keynes. So the question is, which business cycle uses stock adjustment principle? So in theories of business cycle, we have seen that there is only one business model which uses stock adjustment principle in explaining business model, that is Kaldor's model of business cycle. So in Kaldor's model, he has introduced a new variable, which is capital stock, and he basically says that Kaldor's model basically says that it is because of changes in capital stock that a business cycle happens in the economy. So whatever fluctuations are happening in the economy, it is because of changes in capital stock. And that was the first time a person has introduced the term or the concept or the variable capital stock to explain business cycle model. So Nicholas Calder has introduced that particular concept, capital stock, and Kaldor's model says that it is because of changes in capital stock that fluctuations happen in the economy, and which ultimately leads to business cycle. So if the question is about a stock adjustment or capital stock, then that is directly connected with Nicholas Calder, because no other business cycle is connected with stock adjustment principle. Here the stock adjustment principle means changes in capital stock, because that particular variable is introduced by Nicholas Calder in his model of trade cycle. So the stock adjustment principle is associated with Nicholas Calder's model of business cycle. And we'll also look at option B, C, and D. In option B is J.R. Hicks. In Hicks model, he talks about accelerator multiplier interaction. He also talks about upper ceiling and lower limit. Then Paul Samuelson's model. Paul Samuelson also talks about multiplier accelerator interactor. J.M. Keynes. In J.M. Keynes' model, he says that the reason for business cycle is changes in marginal efficiency of capital. So in this, out of all these options, four options, the right answer is Nicholas Calder, because Nicholas Calder's model is the only model which uses stock adjustment or changes in capital stock to explain business cycle models. So the answer is option A. Now we will move on to next question. So this question was asked in 2013 June paper 3. The question is, for particular high values of marginal propensity to consume and the accelerator coefficient, explosive non-oscillatory cycles will occur in the model of the business cycle propounded by. So we have four options. The question is, high values of marginal propensity to consume and the accelerator coefficient leads to explosive non-oscillatory cycle. So the question is like this: marginal propensity to consume and the accelerator coefficient leading to explosive non-oscillatory cycles. So such kind of a situation happen in, or a such kind of a business cycle happen in whose model? That is the question. So we have four options. We have Paul A. Samuelson, J.R. Hicks, Nicholas Calder, all of the above. So in the previous question, we have seen Nicholas Calder, and Nicholas Calder's model, it basically says that it is changes in capital stock or business cycle is created by stock adjustment principle. So Nicholas Calder basically says that a business cycle is because of changes in capital stock or because of stock adjustment principle. The question here is specifically about this question. Uses the term marginal propensity to consume and accelerator coefficient. So we know that two business cycle or two models uses marginal propensity to consume and the and accelerator coefficient to explain business cycle theories. So here marginal propensity to consume indirectly means a multiplier effect, because multiplier is directly related to marginal propensity to consume. Whenever value of marginal propensity to consume is higher, it means the value of multiplier will be higher. So since the question is marginal, since marginal propensity to consume is asked, we have to understand that there they are mentioning about multiplier effect. So whenever marginal propensity to consume is used in a business cycle in terms of business cycle model, then we have to assume that that particular question or that particular mention is totally about multiplier effect. So marginal propensity to consume by here in this question means the or indirectly point towards multiplier effect, because marginal propensity to consume is directly proportional to multiplier effect, and the value of multiplier effect totally depends on marginal propensity to consume. So the question is how in which model multiplier effect and accelerator effect combine together to form non-oscillatory cycles, which explosive non-oscillatory cycles. And we know that only two models uses multiplier accelerator interaction in explaining business cycle, and those two models are Polley-Samuelson's model and J.R. Hicks model. We have seen Calder uses capital principle of capital stock adjustment in explaining business cycle. So we can leave Nicholas Calder is not the right answer. Since Nicholas Calder is not right, the answer option D is also not correct. All of the above is not also correct. So that comes to two options, Polley-Samuelson and J.R. Hicks. Now we have to see which one is the right answer. Earlier in the case of J.R. Hicks, in a previous question, we have seen that in the case of Hicks model, there is an upper ceiling and lower limit, and business cycle happens within that particular limit, and it will be follows a pendulum like a movement, and oscillate this the oscillations are much more systematic or confined within that particular upper ceiling and lower limit. So since it is confined, it forms an oscillatory movement or a pendulum like movement, and it won't have an explosive upswing or an explosive downswing. Whatever cycle is happening, it follows a pendulum like movement and oscillatory kind of movement, and it happens within that upper ceiling and lower limit. So J.R. Hicks model cannot have explosive non-oscillatory cycles in business model. According to J.R. Hicks model, it is impossible to have explosive non-oscillatory cycles. So that will be so that leaves us with one option, Polley-Samuelson. So in the case of Polley-Samuelson, there is an upper limit and lower limit, but that upper limit take place and that upper limit happens at the full employment level, or whenever all the resources are used in the economy, then that would be the maximum level or the upper limit for Samuelson's model. And Samuelson's model, because of there is no ceiling before full employment level, Samuelson's model can also have non-oscillatory explosive upswings or downswing. So you can see explosive movement in terms of Samuelson's business cycle model, while in the case of J.R. Hicks model, such kind of non-oscillatory explosive upswing or downswing cannot be seen. The explosive or a spontaneous or a sudden change in business cycle can seen only in the case of Polley-Samuelson's model. So the answer is Polley-Samuelson. So in this question, the option is option A, Polley-Samuelson. So coming to next question, this question was asked in 2013 December paper 2. So the question is, it is often true that as the economy begins to recover from a recession, the unemployment rate rises. Because the question is, as the economy begins to recover from a recession, the unemployment rate rises. So they are asking why the rate of unemployment increases when an economy is recovering. So whenever an economy is recovering, why there is an increase in unemployment? That is the question. We'll look at the options. So the option A, as the economy initially recovers from a recession, the demand for goods and services falls. So the demand for workers falls. So option A says that as soon as there is a recovery from a recession, demand for goods and services falls. So the option says there is a fall in demand for commodities and services as soon as there is a recovery, which is absolutely wrong. Because whenever a recovery is happening in economy, it means slowly, slowly, the demand for goods and services are increasing, not falling. Whenever there is a recovery from a depression phase or a recession phase, then there won't be a fall in demand. Instead, there will be an increase in demand. So whenever there is a recovery, there should be an increase in demand. A slow increase in demand should be there in the case of recovery. So option A is not correct, since because the option A says that there is fall in demand when there is a recovery, which is false. Whenever a recovery is happening in an economy, there will be increase in demand. So option A is not correct. Coming to option B, as the economy begins to recover from a recession, workers who were previously discouraged about their chances of finding a job begins to look for work again. So option B says that when economy starts to have a recovery phase, those workers, those laborers who were not searching for job earlier, start to search for job, and because of that, unemployment rate is happening. So we have to look at here is that how unemployment rate is calculated. So basically, unemployment rate is calculated based on labor force, the number of workers who are searching for job and willing to work. So that comprises labor force. So when we say labor force, it comprises of people who are searching for job. So when we say labor force, and unemployment rate is calculated based on the number of people in that labor force. So labor force comprises of people who are searching for job, and unemployment rate is calculated based on the number of people in labor force. So when economy recovers, what happens is that suddenly large number of people who were previously not looking for work start to search for job. So people who were not looking or searching for job earlier during the phase of depression will suddenly start to search for job. So once they start searching for job, then automatically they will become a part of labor force. And we can see that these are the initial stages. Option B says that initial stages of recovery. So initial stages of recovery, we can say that there will be a positive trend, there will be increase in demand, there will be increase in employment, but that won't happen spontaneously. It will happen very slowly. So demand increases, employment increases in a very slow pace. So since employment is increasing in a very slow pace, and the number of people who are looking for the jobs are higher, then the rate of unemployment will be higher as compared to depression phase. So basically what happens is that the people who were not searching for the job will start searching for job. That when they start searching for job, the number of people in labor force increases, and the jobs available increases only at a very small pace, because the demand increases slowly, demand in the economy will only increase in a very slow pace. Because of increase in very slow pace, employment will also increase at a very slow pace, and because of low increase in employment and a large number of people searching for job, the rate of unemployment will be higher at the initial stages of recovery. So earlier, this unemployment rate will be higher as compared to the depression phase, because in depression phase, number of people who are searching for job will be lesser, because they are not searching for job, because they know that even if they search for job, there is no jobs available in the market. So there is no point in searching for jobs during the phase of depression. So since optimism is dominant in the case of a depression phase, people won't search for job, and since they are not searching for job, they won't be part of labor force, and since they are not part of labor force, the unemployment rate will be less during the time of depression as compared to the initial stages of recovery. So the answer to this question is option B. So during initial stages of recovery, starting seeing a positive trend, more people will start to search for job. Once they start searching for job, they will be part of labor force, and the unemployment rate is calculated based on labor force. Since number of people searching for jobs are higher at the initial stages, and the development of jobs or a number of jobs available in the market are increasing at a very slow pace, the rate of unemployment will be higher during the initial stages of recovery. After a certain level, the unemployment level will decreases because slowly, slowly, more and more employment will be generated in the economy. So the answer to this question is option B. So we'll also look at option C and D. As the economy begins to recover from a recession, because of the errors in the way data are collected. Option C is not correct because it talks about an error in data collection, which can happen, but which is not always the case. Now we can ignore option C. Coming to option D, as the economy initially recovers from a recession, firms do not immediately increase the number of workers they hire. Firms wait to hire more individuals until they are convinced that the recovery is strong. Option D, we cannot say that option D is 100% wrong. Option D is partially correct. We have to say that option D is partially correct. But the question is about unemployment rate. So when unemployment rate is asked, we have to see the question from a supply point of view, or a supply side, or a labor supply point of view. So we cannot completely ignore option D. Option D is partially correct, but since it is asked about unemployment rate and there is an option which specifically points towards the supply of labor and labor supply, then it is always better to choose that particular option as the correct answer from a supply point of view. So if option B weren't there in this question, then option D would have been the correct answer. But since option B is there in the option which says, as the economy begins to recover from a recession, workers who were previously discouraged about their chances of finding a job begins to look for work again. So that is a little more, you know, better answer in this particular case. Option D is partially correct, but since option B is there, it is the perfect answer to this question. So option B is the right answer. So coming to next question. So this question was asked in 2015 June paper 3. So this is a match the following question. So we have two lists, list 1 and list 2. We have to match accordingly. So we'll start with list 1, option A. In A, it says recession. So in list 1, we have four options: recession, boom, recovery, depression. So we know that recession, boom, recovery, depression are the different phases of business cycle. So the list 1 is totally about different phases of business cycle. And list 2 says low, positive, high level, negative. So first list, we have different phases of a business cycle. And the second list, we have what does each phases represent. So we have to match accordingly. So what does each phases of business cycle represent? That is how we have to match, we have to solve this question. So we'll start with option A, which is recession. So recession is a stage where, we'll start with a recession. We have four options: low, positive, high and negative. We know that recession is a negative phase. Or a phase of negative trend. So we can clearly avoid positive and high level. We can avoid those two options, positive and high level, since recession represents a negative impact in the economy. So then we have two options: low and negative. And we know that recession is the third phase in the business cycle process. We have a recovery phase, depression. We have recovery phase, expansion phase, recession phase, and depression phase. So recession phase is the phase where production or productive activities are much less in the economy, or the output, income, employment, all kind of economic variables are low in the economy. So recession can be rightly matched with low. And we know that negative is directly associated with the depression. So depression phase is the phase where the economy has hit rock bottom, and there is an absolute negative trend in the economy, and we can match depression with negative. And we know that boom is a state of high level production or prosperity, and since it is a high level production, since we can see high level production and prosperity, boom can be matched with high level. And since recovery phase is a phase where you can see a positive trend, or it is the phase where economy slowly recovers from a depression. So it is a state, it is the beginning of a positive trend, or it's just the beginning of a prosperity stage. So recovery phase can be associated with positive. So recession can be associated with low, boom can be associated with high level, recovery can be associated with a positive, depression can be associated with negative. So right answer is option 2 in the code. Answer is option 2. So coming back to, we'll see another question, 2006, July 3rd, paper 3. So in the adjoining standard diagram to explain Hicks straight cycle theory, which of the following are true? When the actual value of MPC and accelerator fall in the region C. So the question is, what happens if the actual value of MPC and accelerator falls in region C, which is this particular region? What will happen to Hicks business cycle when accelerator and multiplier falls in region C? So we have four options. There will be oscillation, cyclical fluctuation. There will be explosive upward movement. There will be steady growth movement. Both 2 and 3 are possible. So it is kind of a direct question. See, if you have properly learned Hicks business cycle, this is kind of a direct question. Even though they have given a diagram here, we can easily solve this question. But can easily solve this question just by just by looking at Hicks model of business cycle and how business cycle is created in Hicks cycle of business model. So we have four options. There will be oscillations, there will be explosive upward movement. We know that there won't be any kind of explosive upward movement in the case of Hicks business cycle. Explosive upward movement can be seen in the case of Samuelson's model, not in the case of Hicks model, because Hicks model there is a upper limit and lower bottom, and the fluctuations happening in the economy are oscillatory in nature. It follows a pendulum like movement, so there won't be explosive movement in the case of Hicks model of business cycle. So wherever, whatever is the value of multiplier or accelerator, Hicks business cycle won't have explosive upward movement or downward movement. So option C is absolutely wrong, and this kind of explosive upward movement can be seen in the case of Samuelson's model, not in Hicks model. And when the option 3, there will be a steady growth. See, in Hicks model we have seen that we have cyclical fluctuations or cyclical oscillation or a systematic oscillation. So there will be growth in business cycle, or positive trend will be there, but it won't be as steady as what is represented in Samuelson's model. There will be positive movement, but that positive movement will be cyclical in nature, oscillatory in nature. It follow a pendulum like movement. So basically, steady growth is also not a logical answer for Hicks model of business cycle. Then the option 4 is 2 and 3, which we have already seen that 2 and 3 are wrong. Then we will be left with one option. There will be oscillation, cyclical fluctuation. So we have already seen that. We have already seen that in Hicks model there is interaction between multiplier and accelerator, but how much ever is the interaction between multiplier and accelerator, the business cycle takes place within a limit. Upper ceiling is there, lower limit is there. So cyclical movement happens within that particular limit, and it follows a kind of a cyclical oscillation or a systematic movement can be seen. So wherever is multiplier and accelerator in the case of Hicks model, we can always see a cyclical movement or a oscillation, cyclical fluctuations or a systematic oscillation in the case of Hicks model. So irrespective of where multiplier and accelerator happening, there will be a systematic oscillations or a cyclical oscillations in the case of Hicks model. So the answer to this question is option 1, there will be oscillations, cyclical fluctuations. So we'll move on to next question. This question was asked in 2017, January, paper 2. So in the trade cycle of J.R. Hicks, long run equilibrium growth is determined by, we have option 1, technology, population, autonomous investment, option 4, both 1 and 2 above. So the question is, the long run equilibrium growth in Hicks model is represented by which of the following? So we know that in the case of Hicks model, the business cycle take place because of interaction between accelerator and multiplier, and this multiplier and accelerator take place, or it comes into the picture because of autonomous investment and derived investment. So in Hicks model, it is a straightforward concept that there is autonomous investment and derived investment. So according to that, in this option, the correct answer is autonomous investment, because Hicks model does not talk about technological progress or population. It mainly focuses on multiplier and accelerator interaction, and that multiplier and acceleration interaction take place because of autonomous investment and derived investment. So basically, the business cycle according to Hicks model is because of autonomous investment, derived investment and multiplier accelerator interaction. So answer to this question is autonomous investment. So option 3 is the right answer. So we'll move on to the next question. This question was asked in 2018 July, paper 2. The theory in which freight cycle is generated due to excess of actual over desired investment has been given by whose amongst the following? So question is, in who says that, in which model it's been mentioned that business cycle is generated because of excess of actual over desired investment? So whose model it's been mentioned that business model is a result of over investment or excess investment, excess of actual over desired investment? So we have four options: R.J. Hotry, Hayek, P. Samuelson, Schumpeter. So we'll look at first option, R.J. Hotry. So Hotry's model basically it talks about Hotry's model is called the pure monetary theory of business cycle. So Hotry's theory specifically focuses on money supply as the reason for business cycle. The theory, the name of the theory itself is quite clear, the pure monetary theory of business cycle. That is the theory proposed, that is the model proposed by R.J. Hotry, and in his model he focuses on money supply, and he says that money supply, changes in money supply, is the reason for business cycle. Coming to F. Hayek's model, the model is known as over investment theory, the over investment theory of business cycle. That is the name of the model given by Hayek. So from the name itself, it is clear that that particular theory talks about over investment. So what has been mentioned in Hayek's theory of over investment is that a business cycle happens in the economy when the actual investment is greater than the required investment. So in other words, whenever the desired investment is greater than the actual required investment, then that will lead to business cycle and other fluctuations in the economy. So option 2 is the right answer, because Hayek's model, which is called the over investment theory of trade cycle, clearly says that business cycle take place because of over investment, excess investment in the economy. In other words, whenever the actual investment is greater than the desired or the required investment, then there will be business fluctuations or business cycle in the economy. So from the model's name itself, it is very clear that actual over desired investment is mentioned in F. Hayek's theory of over investment. FIX theory, which is over investment theory of business cycle. So the right answer to this question is option 2, which is F. Hayek. Now we'll also see option 3 and option 4. In option 3, Paul Samuelson, in his theory, we have already seen that he talks about multiplier and accelerator. And coming to option 4, Schumpeter's theory. In Schumpeter's theory, he basically says that it is technology and changes, it is innovation and technological changes which leads to business cycle in the economy. So there is only one theory which talks about business cycle as a reason. There is only one theory which talks about business cycle, which is because of over investment. That is F. Hayek in his model, in his trade cycle model, which is called over investment theory of trade cycle. So the answer to this question is F. Hayek and option 2. So going to next question, this question was asked in 2018 December 2. So based on real business cycle theory given by neoclassical economist, the reason for business cycle are innovations and bad weather. So here in this option we have innovations, bad weather, tax policy, debt policy, and according to real business cycle theory, it is basically technological shock. For example, technological shock, and technological shock will leads to changes in production technique, which is called as innovation. Bad weather, changes in the composition of raw materials, so according to real business cycle theory, it is innovations and bad weather which leads to business cycle. So here option 1 and 2 are the correct and we have option one, which shows the correct combination one and two. So innovations and bad weather are the reason for business cycle in terms of real business cycle given by neoclassical economist. And looking at tax policy and debt policy, real business cycle economy, the real business cycle model also says that if there is a tax policy or debt policy that will have a adverse effect in the economy, there shouldn't be any kind of tax policy or debt policy, there shouldn't be any kind of government intervention in the economy. They are very adamant about that particular thing, that there shouldn't be any kind of demand boosting policies in the economy, there shouldn't be any kind of government intervention or government policies in the economy. So option three and option four are absolutely wrong, because they are the real business cycle models are absolutely or totally against tax policy and debt policy, which are the policies imposed by government. They are the real business cycle theories totally against fiscal policies or government policies. They says that there shouldn't be any kind of tax policy or debt policy, any other kind of interventions from government. So option 3 and 4 are absolutely wrong, and option 1 and 2 are correct. So we have 1 and 2 the 1 and 2 are the right combination, and it is represented by option 1, and the right answer is option 1. So we'll move on to next question. So 2018, this question was asked in 2018 December paper 2. The question is, below are the two statements, one labeled as assertion A and the other labeled as reason. Read the statement and choose the correct answer using the quote given below. So we'll start with assertion. Assertion A, business cycles according to new classical economics are monetary in nature. Reason are, these are the result of the fall in the real wage rates. So we have assertion and reason, and we have certain option. Now we'll see which one is correct. So we will look at assertion. So assertion says that business cycles according to new classical economics are monetary in nature. So just before, I have told you in the previous question that the new business cycle theories are proposed by neoclassical economists, and they follow classical model and classical dichotomy. So the classical economics basically says that there should be free market in the economy, there shouldn't be any kind of government intervention, and all kind of real variables are influenced by real variables only, or in other words, monetary variables like rate of interest, price doesn't have an influence on real variables. So they focused on real variables, and they said that any kind of economic act, any kind of major changes which are happening in the economy, or all kind of changes which are happening in the economy, is because of real variables like employment, output, etc. So they focus mainly on real variables instead of monetary variables. So, and they also say that there shouldn't be any kind of monetary variables influencing the economy. So they totally says that monetary variables doesn't have any kind of influence in the economy, it is real variables which have real influence in the economy. So they were totally against the monetarism view of economy, they were totally against the monetary variables, they totally focused on real variables, and they followed classical economics and classical dichotomy. So the first assertion, business cycle according to new classical economics are monetary in nature, which is absolutely wrong. Business cycle according to new classical economics are real in nature. They are totally against monetary nature. They say that money shouldn't be given importance, which should only be seen as a medium of transaction. That's it. So business cycle according to new classical economics are not monetary in nature, but the assertion says that they are classical economics are monetary in nature, so which is wrong, because they are totally against monetary view of economy, that follows real classical economics. So assertion A is wrong. Coming to reason, these are the result of falling real wage rates. So classical economist believes that any major changes which is happening in the economy is because of real variables, and real variables include employment, output, etc. And real wages are associated with employment. So since they focus on real employment and real wages and supply side factors, we can say that classical economist and the new classical economist in their model of business cycle, the real business cycle model, they follow, they support real wages, and they says that, they also says that any changes in the business cycle can happen because of real variables like employment and real wages. So basically, in a new business cycle model, it's been said that any major change that has happened in the economy is because of real variables like employment, wage rate, etc. So wage rate, employment are the factors which are strong enough, or which are the factors which can influence, you know, certain other variables in the economy and leads to business fluctuation. So according to real business cycle theory or real business cycle model, fluctuations in the economy can happen because of real variables like unemployment, real wages, etc. So reason R is correct in this question. So assertion A is wrong and reason R is correct. So A is false but R is true is the right answer, and that is chord 1. So chord 1 is the right answer here in this question. So moving on to next question, 2019 December. This question was asked in 2019 December. It was asked in paper 2. The question is a match to the following question. We have marginalistic revolution, multiplier accelerator model, ISLM curves, real business cycle. So we'll try to solve this question in terms of theories of business cycle. So we have multiplier accelerator. We know what is multiplier accelerator model, and we know that two economists have talked about multiplier accelerator model in their business cycle model. So those two economists are Hicks and Samuelson, and those two are Hicks and Samuelson are there in the option also. So since both of them are asked in the question, just leave it like that. We'll go to next theory of business cycle, which is real business cycle. And real business cycle, it is quite clear that real business cycle theory has been proposed by neoclassical economists, and neoclassical economists like in the option we have Samuelson, J.R. Hicks, Javos, and Robert J. Borow. And we know that Robert J. Borow is a neoclassical economist. When we learnt real business cycle theory, we have seen that Borow has contributed towards the model of real business cycle. Since there is a contribution from Robert J. Borow towards real business cycle models, we can associate Robert J. Borow with real business cycle theories, because he is a neoclassical economist and he has contributed towards real business cycle theory. So we can directly connect Robert J. Borow with real business cycle theory. And we know that J.R. Hicks is associated with ISLM curves, because J.R. Hicks has contributed towards ISLM curves. Since there is a contribution from Hicks towards ISLM curves or ISLM model, we can associate Hicks with ISLM curves. So the option Hicks is matched with ISLM curves. Then we have multiplier accelerator model. Since Hicks is not there and Hicks is matched with ISLM curves, we can easily match multiplier accelerator model with Samuelson. And so that means we have seen we have answered three questions in this match the following that left that three questions in this match the following, and we only have one option remaining, that is marginalistic revolution, which can be connected with Javos. So the right answer here is option 1. So we have completed all the questions which were asked from theories of business cycle model in the previous year's question paper. I hope everybody understood this explanation I have given here. Thank you.